Welcome, everybody. I'm Cliff Lynch. I'm the director of the Coalition for Networked Information, and I'm here to welcome you to one of the project briefing sessions of our Spring 2020 virtual member meeting, which will be running until the end of May. We'll be hearing a presentation today from MJ Tooey of the University of Maryland, Baltimore. And after she's done, Diane Goldenberg-Hart from CNI will moderate Q&A. There is a Q&A button at the bottom of your screen, and you can use that to type in questions for MJ at any point during her presentation as they occur to her, to you, and I will, we will save them all till the end, and Diane will work through those then. So with that, let me just briefly introduce our topic today, which is the development of a unified, intentional, and evolving approach to research support. And I think all of those words are really important. Unified and intentional are both critical. And if we've learned anything over the past couple of months, evolving is the name of the game these days. And I believe that MJ is going to share some of her experience in adapting research support strategies during the last couple of months, as well as the thinking that led up to where the University of Maryland, Baltimore found itself in early March. And with that, I'll just welcome you all again. Thank you for joining us. MJ, thank you so much for doing this presentation, and over to you.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you, Cliff, for the introduction. I appreciate it. It's delightful to be here. As time has gone on, certainly my topic has evolved and been more intentional, and hopefully will be a unified approach to talk about how we approach research support at the University of Maryland, Baltimore. So again, delightful to be here. One of the things I need to make sure that I do before I get started is say that I have to give a big shout out to Alexa Mayo, who is our Associate Director for Services, without whom we would not have come as far as we have come in supporting research over the last few years at the University of Maryland, Baltimore. Those of you that are familiar with the University of Maryland, Baltimore know that we, it's not going. Let's see here. Let's try here. There we go. Those of you that are familiar with the University of Maryland, Baltimore know that we are in an urban setting and we are a health sciences, human services institution. So health sciences, meaning that we're medicine, nursing, pharmacy, dentistry. The human services side is social work and law. And so we are a smaller research institution, but our research portfolio is big. We do about almost $700 million worth of research every year. So we're no strangers to a research enterprise. One of the things that really occurred to me when I was submitting this abstract was the fact that I attended a wonderful, wonderful session after CNI in December 2019 about critical roles for libraries in today's research enterprise. And it was absolutely timely and has proven to be even more so over the last couple months. But as the report came out early in 2020, which seems like years ago now, the top four key challenges that the report identified were reorganization to support new roles, single customer-facing service, communication and marketing, and partnering with the research office. And as I thought about submitting an abstract, I realized that over the last 5 to 6 years, we have really had those same challenges. And so I thought, well, let's see if I can develop something and tell you a little bit about how we have engaged with those challenges. I can't say we've solved them all, but we certainly engaged with them. So it, as with most things, it all begins with a vision and an idea, and it never gets executed without being a very detailed plan. So we're going to talk a little bit about my main responsibilities in this, which had to do with the idea that we really needed to support the research enterprise better. I'm in charge of strategic thinking and innovation as the director of the library and as the associate vice president for academic affairs. So my job is to make sure that we're always moving forward. And I would also say that anybody who knows me in the library says that I'm a relentless promoter of the library and all the wonderful things we do, because we do amazing things there. So let's get going and talk a little bit about how over six years ago, so it has some legs, the leadership team in the library embarked on a strategic listening tour. It was time for us to do a new library strategic plan. The university was working on a new plan. We had just had a new president put in place about, 7 years ago. And so strategic planning was on everyone's mind. So we decided to engage in a strategic listening tour where we talked to the deans, senior leadership, certainly the research office, key stakeholders like the faculty senate, the staff senate, the student organizations, all to help inform our new library strategic plan, because we knew we needed to do something different. We needed to be more out there and outwardly focused. One of the key questions, or the key question that we asked these leaders, was to envision their success, whether it was their school, their division, their unit. And so to find out what was their best future and what we could do to ensure their success. So as you can imagine, being a university, there was some conversation about education, and being a healthcare institution, some conversation about supporting clinical care. But in truth, the overriding theme that came through had to do with research success. In the competition for resources and a renewed focus kind of on entrepreneurship and innovation. What was really humbling for us was that there was very little understanding of the entirety of all the things the library could do. Our expertise, our services, our resources. People still continue to think of us as being the building that had books and journals and was a great place for people to study. We had things online and that was it. But really had not embraced something we thought we had embraced and communicated a lot about, which was our expertise. So as we wrote our strategic plan, we came up with our key challenges. And you'll see that they are very much parallel to the key challenges that were identified in the December programming from CNI. First of all, we needed to identify the essential research services that we were going to be retaining and continuing to offer, and what needed, and trying to figure out what needed to be added. We knew we needed to enhance the library, faculty, librarian, and staff expertise. We needed to build a holistic service supporting research from idea to impact, or as we jokingly say, from womb to tomb. From the time they come up with an idea to the time it's published, shared, however it's going to have an impact in the greater scientific community. And we would need to brand and market. So we were going to build a research service. And I can say that if you look at the top four challenges from December, it's very familiar. So first of all, item one, identify essential services. We did a big job of assessing researcher needs. We did surveys, we did conversations, we did strategic listening, we had focus groups, we had every possible way there was to ask questions about what do researchers need, talk to the research office, everything. We wanted to identify and align services that we were already doing that were vital to the research life cycle. And those of you, again, are, I'm sure, very familiar with what is involved in the research life cycle, the circle of the research life. We also identified libraries with similar services. In this case, we were very interested in bioinformatics and in things like systematic reviews. So we received a small award to go on a road trip to, we went to WashU in St. Louis to talk to them about their bioinformatics services. And we went to the University of Florida to talk about their systematic review services in their health sciences library. And then the real work began. And I can't stress how valuable this was. We developed a 12-page matrix. And the 12-page matrix was on the big paper, not just the 8.5 by 11. And it identified what needed to be done. What did we want to do? What did we want to expand? It identified who needed to do it. What skill sets did we need? Did we have those skill sets in-house? Where did we need to build more skills? Where do we need to hire different people? And of course, the big question that the director always gets is, well, how are we going to pay for all this? You know, where are we going to get the resources and funding to do these things? And then finally, a timeline. And our timeline was very aggressive. And it was also involved a lot of changing some of our physical space to embrace supporting research, moving to a one service desk, adding some additional features in the library. So the second step for us, of course, was enhancing library faculty and staff expertise. And to identify the knowledge gaps. We knew sort of from our matrix what we wanted to do. Where didn't we have any expertise? Where do we think we could get expertise? We wanted to look at things like systematic review training, molecular biology, bioinformatics. And so we sent people to the systematic review training that used to be held at the University of Pittsburgh. And I believe every single one of our librarians went to that training at one time or another over the next couple years, over the interceding years. We sent a number of people to the bioinformatics program that the National Library of Medicine used to host. And we learned all about omics, proteomics, genomics, any other omics that were out there, we were learning about them. And also just to note that this is an ongoing thing. Once we identified the knowledge gaps, once we identified the training opportunities, this has gone on and continued. Every time we need to learn something new, we learn something new. We've made a commitment. We spend a lot of money on staff training and staff development. Never has a director been more grateful than when things started appearing more in webinars so that I could send multiple people to one program at a time, and so that there were opportunities for people to learn things all at once. And then we identified staffing gaps. This was difficult because, again, you know, in many institutions, they don't just give you new positions. So you have to make use of positions that become open over time and retool them and convince people that it's a better idea to use the positions in one way or another. So we ended up taking some of our positions and we ended up identifying an emerging technologies librarian who works primarily in our innovation space, which was one of our new areas. We also hired a molecular biologist who is our data scientist. Recently, we added a data librarian who works kind of with our data scientist on kind of more the library side. We have an instructional designer that isn't a librarian at all. And we quickly realized that there are a lot of times when it's not necessarily librarians we need to have, but a community of people that can support research enterprise and can talk to the researchers the way they like to be, talked to. We built a holistic service. We identified the key services that were supporting research and we integrated the new components. And some of them I've already mentioned, systematic reviews, research impact reports. For example, we work with the School of Medicine every year with their promotion and tenure reports to take a look at the people who are up for promotion and tenure and talk about the impact of their research or their publications. So that's something we do. Data management, we've been working closely with researchers writing grants to help them with their data management plans. What we realized was that it was not going to be a new division in the library. In the library, we have services, resources, technology, administration, and we're the regional medical library for the southeastern United States. So we have 57 staff. There was no need to slice and dice and make another department because what we wanted the department to be was multidisciplinary. So as we have this expertise and as somebody calls for some particular type of expertise, somebody could come in from services, they could be teamed up with somebody from technology, they could be teamed up with somebody from resources. So it's multidisciplinary and goes across the library this way as opposed to in silos. And we add new components as they're needed. Some of the building enhancements I mentioned were a high performance computing center, an innovation space, and our presentation practice studio. I think perhaps our greatest challenge has been branding and marketing. I don't know that we are in the library community the best branders and marketers. I think we tend to think we communicate a lot, but we learn from our strategic listening that once you communicate, you think you're communicating a lot, you need to ratchet it up and communicate some more because people only hear what they need to hear when they need to hear it. And so it's a constant pushing things out. And so we developed one-stop shopping for research support where we put our suite of services and we aggregated them in one place on our webpage. Now, that does not mean that a person, if they want to use any particular research service, has to go through that gateway. If they know that they need a systematic review, there's a way for them to get to systematic reviews. Originally, we branded it as being Research Connection, Expertise to Advance Your Success. That was our original name. We've thrown that out because that was meaningless. Now we just have a question, doing research, and we have a lot of our elements, and I'll show you a screenshot. And of course, marketing and promoting has been a big deal. We are always talking about how we support research, and we do get a lot of traction from that. I think we're seen as valuable members in many areas of the research team. Some of the things that we've added that are included, and you'll see these slides later, they'll be shared so you can take a look more closely. But some of the things that we offer as part of our research service have to do with things like systematic reviews. We've always done research consultations. We added things like data wrangling and visualization, and that's maturing now in the library as we continue to work with that. Another thing that's very interesting is we don't all sit, but a number of the library staff sit on the institutional review board. And one of the services we started to offer as part of that service was to look at consent forms and turn consent forms into plain language so that researchers can communicate with subjects a little more easily. We're also in the process of developing a citizen science online certificate course that should be completed, I hope, by the fall. Knock on wood. Anyway, so that's some of the stuff we offer, but we're constantly reimagining, realigning, and evolving this. And this has never been more necessary than in the last couple of months. So we are aligned with the university's strategic plan, which is a core of what we do. Theme 2 in our university strategic plan is research and scholarship, and this dovetails and is often cited as being a good example of how this particular theme is supported. We have ongoing conversations with the research community, Office of Research and Development. We also put together an HSHSL Research Advisory Committee, which is made up of the research deans from all the schools. We are constantly reviewing and evaluating, assessing, and adding new things in. We have redesigned and rebranded, which I alluded to, and we are constantly promoting, if not the service itself, certain elements of the service. This is what the website looks like as of the day before yesterday. And you can see down in the lower middle section, it says doing research. And if you click any one of those areas, you'll go to certain things, like help with your research takes you to a whole raft of things. Covenants we added this year, which is a software program that aids in putting together systematic reviews and organizing things. Our bioinformatics and innovative technologies people are down in the lower left of that blue box. And the systematic review service, which is incredibly popular, has its own little cube as well, its own little square. Unfortunately, COVID-19 interrupted yet another reimagining of the research enterprise where we were actually going to redo the webpage. And we were in the process of doing usability testing, or just about to start usability testing in late March, and everything kind of disappeared then. So we're working on some ideas about how to do usability testing with some new design and engage some of our users to help in a virtual way to do usability testing. We're still working out some kinks on that. So some of the suggestions, I think, you know, I always say, oh, these are Captain Obvious, you know, for building a service like this. But, you know, you really do need to assess and align with user and research community needs. We made the mistake for many years that I think a lot of our libraries do, which is the libraries develop their strategic plans and develop their services based on what they think users need. And I can't stress enough about how we really need to partner and align with our research community and with the research users, individual researchers. Every year we get a list from the research office who our most highly funded users are and take a look at what they're studying, what their maybe particular needs are. We talk to them if we have the capability to do that. Any way we can insert ourselves into research, we try. You need to know your strengths and what you can and cannot do. We're a big health sciences library, but we're not a big library compared to maybe a larger research institution. So we really need to know what we're good at and what we really can't pick up and do. We need to know what other people at the university are doing too, so that we're not crossing paths and getting in somebody else's way that's doing good work. So we do spend a lot of time, and they and others on the campus do time too, where they talk to us and say, well, we're doing this, and we promote what they do, and they promote what we do. So it's pretty good. Assessing the staff training and staffing needs, the marketing plan, if you need to, call in. If you don't have experts in your library, call in people from the university to say, you know, is there a brand that we should look like? We try to imagine what success looks like for us, and we try to evaluate that. And of course, I always say promote like crazy. So let's talk about COVID-19 real quickly here. The downside of the COVID-19 absence, and we've been out since March 14th, and I learned this week that we will probably not be back on site in our fullness, maybe potentially as late as next May. That's a pretty interesting thing. We'll be working on plans for how we get partial staff in, but lack of access to print collections, that's key to the researchers. Some of them are looking at things that are foundational to some of the research they're doing that goes back prior to anything being digitized or available. Our innovation space is a place where we've been doing a lot of 3D printing and prototyping. And so as part of this, our emerging technologies librarian crept into the library and stole a 3D printer and has now been cranking out masks and mask pieces and ear savers. And our poster printing service, we think, is probably just going to die because unless people go to public meetings or have public displays, we won't be printing posters. And our presentation practice studio is lagging as well. However, in the 6 weeks from March 14th to May 1st, we launched about 6 systematic review collaborations, and each one of those takes about 40 hours to complete. So a systematic review is not, it's very time and labor intensive. Literature searches, and you can see the data, 19, research consultations, faculty, reference questions, 281. And this is just a little snapshot of some of the things we're doing. The researchers are going gung-ho, and especially the ones that are doing research on COVID-19. And as you can imagine, on a health sciences campus, that's huge for us. Interlibrary loans, our interlibrary loan fill rate, which is important sometimes, is usually around 95%. It has slumped to 87% because of our lack of access to print collections. So new initiatives that we're doing while we're away, we're conceptualizing and planning what we're calling the CBAD, the Center for Bioinformatics and Data. And so we are working much the same way we did to bring the research consultation service or the research service on board. We're applying those same principles to start up, you know, to kind of standing up a center for bioinformatics and data. We are working with our friends across town at JHU on looking into collaboration tools because we have a joint CTSA award with them. And so that's where we're going there. We've been asked to design a summer elective, an online elective for students on research. We're looking at developing a potential certificate course in data management that would be offered during mini semesters throughout the year. And we have converted all our classes to online format and we are developing new classes. Some of the classes that we're working on or have already been converted, as you can see, they're very much research support and very much data support and very much just the whole research lifecycle supporting from choosing the right journal and introducing, you know, introduction to social, to systematic reviews. So there's quite a wealth of things. And this is just, again, a sampling. So what do I think the future of research is? Well, this has really turned us over kind of over the last, I would say, 9 weeks. I think that's what's going to end up happening is for the time being, people are going to follow the money. They're going to see where the funding, the research funding is for either finding cures or treatments or better ways to combat COVID-19 or predict what is going to come next. So as the money comes out, that's where our researchers are going to follow it. We're fortunate that we have an Institute for Human Genomics and we have Robert Gallo's Center for Vaccine Development at UMB. So we're seeing some very active research going on. And of course, what are the perceived and real needs for research? So what needs to be done? A lot more partnerships. That's actually my last point, collaborations. And as we know, as politics change in the United States, whatever influences the Department of Health and Human Services will have an impact on NIH, who are huge funders at UMB. And so whatever the hot topic is, whether it's the cancer moonshot, AIDS, HIV, back in the day of George Bush, parish nursing. And we'll also, I think, funding for research will go to people who have had past success. You know, money seems to follow the successful researcher. So we will spend a lot of time watching our research community and trying to figure out where we need to jump next as well. So with that, I'm kind of finished here. And I would be happy to answer any questions if there are any. And I'm sure these slides will be shared. And thank you again for the opportunity.
Thank you, MJ. That was a really interesting And particularly given your perspective being right in the middle of things right now, as we're in the middle of this crisis. So we really appreciate your coming to CNI to share some of the experiences you had prior to the crisis and the update after. And I just want to remind everyone to please type your questions into the Q&A box, and I will read them aloud so that MJ can field them here live. And with that, I will go ahead and dive into the question we have received from Sarvani, who asks, in your strategic planning efforts, identifying stakeholders and partners, did you work with the Office of Information Technology? If so, can you please share some thoughts on that?
That's a great question, and they are one of our most avid partners. The Center for Information Technology Services actually is my co-dues payer for CNI. They are, at UMB, their main responsibility is to support infrastructure. And so they are making sure that the network is running, et cetera, et cetera. However, we have had an intersection recently, and particularly some responsibilities I have in the area of data, but we are always conversing with them. You know, I probably on the phone at least weekly or on Teams or whatever, at least weekly talking with our CIO. We have a great relationship with them. The thing that I do need to point out is the library itself has its own IT team, and we have 7 people in that, which is a great luxury to be able to have our own IT team, which takes care of library related things, but also any innovative technology that we bring into the library, we develop, we work with the IT folks on the campus to make sure it rides on the network appropriately. So yes, we did.
Okay, that's great. That was a great question. Thanks so much, Sarvani. Mm-hmm. And thanks for that answer, MJ. I was also wondering if you could speak a little bit to the impact. I think you said that you are producing some impact reports. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit more about what you're reporting, how you're gathering that data, and what's happening with that?
We have a liaison program, as many libraries do, and our liaison to the School of Medicine has a faculty appointment in the Department of Epidemiology. So that's sort of related, but as she became more involved with the School of Medicine, especially after the faculty appointment, the university had entered into this cooperative work with the University of Maryland College Park, our sister university down the road. And they wanted to test the efficacy of collaborations between the College Park faculty and the UMB faculty. And so we developed a methodology where we took a look at H indexes, we took a look at where things were published, we took a look at how things were referenced, and Andrea really developed the methodology for doing this. And after she did such a successful job at it, you know, be careful what you wish for, the dean's office said, we could really use those reports for our faculty who are going up for promotion and tenure. We want to see what the impact of their research is. We want to take a look and see who their collaborators are. We want to see if they're who's citing their research, all those kind of things. So every year she works with whatever the number of people are that are being promoted to work with them to develop as part of their dossier, mm-hmm. an impact report of what the impact of their research and their funding has been, how much funding they've gotten. We are starting to do that with our dental school now, mm-hmm. and in a smaller sense, a much smaller sense, with the School of Nursing as well.
Terrific, so interesting. Thank you, thanks for that. Cliff has a follow-up to the IT question. Mm-hmm. He's wondering, does Maine IT handle high-performance computing, for example, to support genomics, or is that handled elsewhere?
A little bit of everything. The IGS, the Institute for Genomic Sciences, has an incredible array of computers and everything else. And so central IT provides, this could have changed in the last week and I may not know it, but they provide backup storage for all the IGS data. But IGS pretty much has their own computing. However, we have been asked by the Institute for Genomic Sciences to work with them and to work with Central Campus IT. We would be providing a lot of the what I would call informational training support Campus IT provides a storage. Lately, there's been some discussion at the university about primary data storage, and certainly central IT has been, reluctant is way too strong a word, but has been a little bit hesitant to move into central data storage because they feel that things are happening in Azure and OneDrive and all kinds of other places where people could be storing their data. There are ongoing conversations about whether this is going to change and whether we are going to end up doing things like centralized data storage at the university. But right now, I think that conversation has got to be on hold for a little bit till we see what the economic impact of COVID-19 is going to be.
Yeah, interesting. And actually, Sarvani weighed in thanking Cliff for the question because as a HPC manager, part of central IT at my university, that was the focus of my question. So,
And you know, it's interesting, the HPC, the high performance computing that we have that is run by our data scientist is a really, really heavy duty, basically workstation.
Yeah.
And so that's where we're ending up doing a lot of data wrangling and dating and data investigation. Mm-hmm. And because there seems to be one of the gaps that we've identified has been researchers generate the data, researchers get the data back, but in this world of visualization and everything, there's a gap between getting from there to the publication or mm-hmm. to how they present their data. Mm-hmm. So we have moved into a niche where we're doing a little bit of, not a little bit, we're doing a lot of wrangling mm-hmm. and could do a lot more if we had more staff to do it. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting. It's just an interesting time all around data. We talk about it weekly, and there are pros and cons to many different approaches is what we're discovering.
Yeah, and what we learned at our executive roundtable on research continuation and support is that a lot of the gaps are starting to bubble up to the surface. The gaps in service are bubbling up as a result of some of the previous types of support that researchers were getting now disappearing. For instance, you know, student support in wrangling data, and the faculty has come to the library on some occasions looking for training in those areas. Is that something you all are seeing as well?
Yes, we're seeing that as well. And I don't want to understate the importance of the time that's being spent on policy mm-hmm. because we are working to develop trusted relationships with the clinical enterprise for their, whatever, 8 million records of patient data, mm-hmm. and how will we get to that? Who will have access? How do you vet, you know, just the whole authenticating people getting access to that data. So I spend a significant amount of time in policy meetings too, kind of from a, I'm kind of represent kind of the end user area on that, but
a lot of stuff. Yeah, and as a follow-on to the data wrangling question, Cliff is asking, he states, data wrangling is really important and a huge need. Can you tell us how much staff you have committed to that currently?
Two. It's just a very, very much a service in its infancy. We are also looking, since we have only two people, that, and they're not 100% dedicated to that, by the way. They do other informatics and wrangling things, but we're kind of using the teach a man to fish methodology, which is, let's see what kind of training we can do that will help people do wrangling on their own, and then we can help them when they get stuck. We can get them started. We can be a vehicle to make that a more the norm. Sure. I was taken by, who did I hear? I guess I heard, I don't know, the name is escaping me. I think he spoke in CNI, but he's out at in California, where he came to talk at UMB, and I was so taken by the fact that he was talking about how students, medical students in their first year, are all required to take a programming language. Mm. That it, we don't need French and German anymore. We need R and Python. And I think there was a requirement out at the University of California system, at least with their medical schools, that that's one of the things that required. And we would love to see that.
Yeah.
We've been looking into library carpentries to get ourselves trained as trainers. Mm-hmm. And so that we can, again, expand that whole universe of what we can do.
Yeah.
But it is a big focus.
Lots of opportunities for sure.
Yeah.
Lots to do. Yeah. Well, MJ, this has really been delightful. Thank you so much. And Cliff also says, fascinating. Thanks. The demand for wrangling is near infinite. Indeed.
True that.
I want to thank our attendees for joining us. And thanks again to everyone for being here. And
thank you.
Great presentation. Very much appreciated. And thanks so much, everyone. Take care.